In this video, I will be discussing and performing a lamentation, or lament in F minor, by Johann Jakob Froberger. The full title of the piece reads, Lamentation faite sur la mort très douloureuse de Sa Majesté Impériale Ferdinand le Troisième et se jouait lentement avec discrétion, which translates to Lament written on the very painful death of His Imperial Majesty Ferdinand III and played slowly with discretion. Clearly, this is a very descriptive title that contains a wealth of information. To begin with, it tells us for whom it was written, and as Ferdinand III, who was Froberger's employer, died in 1657, we also know the year the lament was written. In addition, it provides us with a valuable indication regarding its performance, and I will examine it in more detail later in the video. In terms of form, the piece is subdivided into three sections, each of which is meant to be repeated. The way I see it, within the context of Froberger's time, such a three-part form with repeats alludes to the pavane, which has the same three-part structure. Stylistically speaking, I don't think this piece is a pavane, especially as it contains many elements that make it sound more like an improvisation than a dance movement. However, I think that Froberger's choice of form is not accidental, especially because pavanes could often be associated with sadness. Think, for instance, of John Dowland's song Flow My Tears, which is in the form of a pavane. F minor was certainly an unusual tonality for that time and goes beyond the limits of standard quarter comma mean tone. While we don't know what temperament Froberger would have used, I think that when a composer ventures into an unusual tonality, our choice of temperament should reflect its unusualness. So, while quarter comma mean tone would definitely be way too spicy, our choice of temperament should maintain a fair amount of spiciness and not become too bland. It's also important to keep in mind that we're dealing with a lament, so every harmony is not necessarily meant to sound pleasant. The Rameau temperament I regularly use works quite well for this piece because F minor is about as far as it can go in the circle of flat tonalities, and the harmonic tension created by a temperament almost being pushed to its limits suits the character of a lament. I would like to offer some performing suggestions with Froberger's own indication serving as a starting point. Let me first show you the opening measures of the score, because there are a couple of details I would like you to notice. First of all, you see Froberger's descriptive title, although for our purposes right now, let's concentrate on his statement that the piece should be played lentement, avec discrétion, slowly with discretion. The second thing I want you to notice, and also keep in mind, concerns the intricate rhythmic details of the score itself. The indication lentement, avec discrétion, can be interpreted in a couple of ways. What may be slightly unclear is whether with discretion refers exclusively to the choice of a slow tempo, or whether it also implies discretion in terms of rhythmic freedom. A little context is necessary here. Avec discrétion is an indication that appears in other pieces by Froberger. While it can appear on its own, it tends to be included in pieces or sections of pieces whose tempo is moderate or slow, like allemands or laments, and where sometimes the word lentement also appears. Writing in the 18th century, the theorist Johann Mattheson specifically referred to Froberger's style of writing when he stated that discretion means that, quote, one need not keep strictly to the tempo, but rather may play now slowly, now quickly, according to one's own preference, end quote. Now, obviously, this quote does not necessarily tell us the whole story, but for the purposes of this video, I think it serves as a good starting point for the exploration of the term discrétion. Personally, I think the combination with the word lentement means that discrétion refers both to the choice of tempo and rhythmic freedom. I will explain how this influences my approach to this piece, but as always, keep in mind this simply reflects my understanding of this issue. Let's start with ideas on how to arrive at an appropriate lentement tempo, keeping in mind that there is no fixed tempo and that your final decision will be influenced not only by your own feel for the piece, but also the specific instrument you're using. First of all, as with Baroque music in general, what guides my choice of tempo usually involves the unit of the beat and the rate of harmonic change. In slightly simplistic terms, I don't look so much at what the right hand does, but rather concentrate on the left hand. This is arguably even more important for this particular piece, because the right hand, rather than having a melody, is predominantly made up of embellished harmonies. So the way I approach the indication to play slowly is to find a tempo in which the quarter notes succeed one another at a rate that may be slow, but not so slow that we lose track of the quarter note pulse. Such a tempo also allows the harmony to maintain a forward motion, and in this way, the harmonic richness and the numerous harmonic twists can maintain their expressive power. And to me at least, such a moderately conceived slow tempo that is not too slow is also consistent with playing slowly avec discrétion. Now, let's consider avec discrétion in terms of rhythmic freedom. This is arguably the trickiest aspect in the performance of this piece, especially given that Froberger apparently did not feel that the score provided sufficient guidance to the performer. Froberger spent the last years of his life living in the Château d'Héricourt, which belonged to his patroness and student Sibylla, Duchess of Württemberg. Near the end of his life, Froberger gave Sibylla the manuscripts of his music with the request that they not be circulated. In a letter to Constantijn Huygens, Sibylla explained that Froberger feared many would not know how to go about playing his music and would only waste it. So, if Froberger thought his contemporaries would be unable to perform his music properly, imagine the challenges we face trying to make sense of all of this 350 years later, when aesthetic and performing conventions have been so radically transformed. But these challenges can also be very stimulating and inspiring, and in many respects encourage us to engage even more deeply with the music. Considering I've just talked about discrétion as implying rhythmic freedom, and that I have repeatedly suggested in previous videos that Baroque scores should not be interpreted literally, my first recommendation will probably come as a surprise, because what I would recommend to anyone beginning to study this piece is to start by interpreting the rhythm as literally and as precisely as possible. Of course, the final performance should not resemble in any way this literal approach. However, the reason I think it is important to start practicing in this way is because, as you saw in the first few measures of the score, Froberger has notated a lot of quite intricate rhythmic detail that, in many respects, in my opinion at least, aims to create the effect of rhythmic freedom. And even if this level of rhythmic detail cannot be anything other than an imperfect approximation of the type of rhythmic freedom he must have been after, it is still important to be aware of what exactly it was that he notated. In other words, before being rhythmically free, we should be aware of what it is we're being free from. It is also important to be able to maintain a regular pulse of quarter notes so that, once again, any decision to speed up or slow down the pulse is done deliberately and in full awareness rather than haphazardly speeding up or slowing down. I would also like to suggest thinking of playing avec discrétion at the level of the individual gestures rather than the actual pulse of the piece. In other words, shaping gestures in a rhythmically freer way than what the notation suggests, and letting larger scale rhythmic flexibility at the level of the beat occur mostly at harmonically significant moments. To me, this approach also makes the final performance more engaging because, on the one hand, it allows the piece to maintain a certain rhythmic structure, and on the other hand, it makes any rhythmic freedom far more expressively meaningful, precisely because there is a recognizable rhythmic foundation that enhances the dramatic impact of any deviation. Let me now demonstrate very briefly some of these ideas I was talking about, and keep in mind that sometimes it's a little difficult to be talking and demonstrating at the same time, especially in regards to tempo. So this is probably going to be an imperfect demonstration. I hope that the actual performance will be a little more meaningful, but I hope to at least give you an idea of some of the things that I'm talking about. When I first mentioned maintaining a steady tempo, at least the way I think of it, and I think everyone has a different way of doing this. Now, because I mentioned that this is a fairly intricate notation, I do regard the unit of the beat as the quarter note. However, for me at least, it helps if I, for the very beginning, when I first start looking at the piece, I kind of start thinking of each one of the 16th notes in my mind. So I'm actually counting 16th notes. Now, obviously, you can't see me counting because this is a mental thing. But let me just show you a little bit. I want to play the first few measures in a strict tempo. And notice how, even if we do this, I know this is not what the final performance should be like. However, you can still make this meaningful and musically convincing in its own way. And I think it's important to try to do that from the very beginning. Etc., etc. Now, we can be a little more flexible with this, but again, what I would suggest is trying to be flexible not so much at the level of the quarter note pulse, but the actual gestures, in other words, these ideas. So instead of going completely rhythmically accurate here and going, you could do something like this, for instance. So I'm giving it a little more individual shape. Another thing that I do, just again to show you a couple of ideas, but each one of you is going to have to interpret this in their own terms. When I played the 16th note run at the very right before I stopped, we have this passage. Sorry. What I would actually do is speed through these 16th notes, this run, and then wait here a little bit before going back to the F, so that I'm actually speeding through the gesture, but by hesitating at the end, I kind of maintain the quarter note pulse fairly regular, so that it could be something like this. Again, a few examples to consider when you want to play this piece on your own. One final performing aspect I wanted to discuss was observing the repeats. There is a case to be made that since this is a lament, it could be considered more of a through-composed piece and therefore played without repeats. However, the manuscript does indicate repeats, and to me, this is more than an empty nod to convention. As I mentioned before, there is a formal allusion to the pavane, and given the affective connections between the pavane and the lament, repeating the sections emphasizes the indebtedness of this piece to the pavane. What is very important from a performing standpoint is to ensure that the repeats don't feel like mere repeats, but that they bring something new to the table. In other words, as performers, we must make sure that we have something new to say so that the repeats sound convincing and necessary. And by this, I don't simply mean just adding ornamentation, which, considering the character of this piece, should not be overdone, but rather finding a new way to navigate through each section. Let me show you one example by looking at arguably the most difficult passage in terms of making its repetition convincing, which is the ending of the piece. It is certainly a very dramatic and memorable ending that consists of a written out arpeggiation of an F major chord spanning three octaves with a final high F stated three times. Let me show you what it sounds like, and I will begin a little earlier so that you can hear it within a more meaningful context. There can be different symbolic interpretations of this gesture. For instance, it could represent Ferdinand's ascent to heaven, but regardless of how you choose to interpret its symbolism, this gesture is very striking and also has a strong sense of finality to it, thus making any continuation after it problematic. My approach is to try and minimize its distinctiveness and its impact when I play it the first time by presenting it as matter-of-factly as possible and observing the notated rhythmic values, while the second time I try to make it much more dramatic, especially by hesitating before playing the final F. Let me show you what I mean by this. So the first time I play this arpeggiation, I could be kind of literal about it, so. And the second time, I could do something like this. So, some ideas on how to approach what is, in my opinion at least, one of the most gorgeous, one of the most beautiful pieces in all of 17th century harpsichord literature. As always, thank you for watching, and I hope you enjoy the performance.